us. We just want to thank everyone who assisted last, shifting things, moving.
the hope and the promise of eternal life. And God, we just claim that today. We may have loved ones or someone we know that's in that sacred and holy time right now. It's a time when they begin to be between worlds because you're calling them closer to you. And that families are tugging to hold them so tight because they don't want to let them go. But oh my goodness, it is a journey that we have been promised. You see, we celebrate today that through Jesus' death and resurrection, he has the keys to hell and death. We don't have to live with the prospect of death and hell with him through Jesus Christ. It's a very big prospect without him. But through him, we know that while our bodies here die, we don't. We go from glory to glory. That's what your scripture says. We go from this world to the next. We take off mortality, put immortality. That's what Jesus tells us. And so, God, for those who are in that place, we ask that you give them comfort and strength. For those in the journey, just strength for the journey of peace and knowing that you are God and you've got this. For family, let them know that as much as you had they love this person, you love them even more. And God, give them peace. Oh God, there are many who need your healing touch that are in various stages of recovery. Some with diagnosis, some with uncertainty. And God, we just invite you into the midst of that. As your children, we boldly claim healing. We proclaim it over them. Your healing, a healing that transcends everything. It's not just physical. It's emotional. It's mental. It's spiritual. And it can be relational, God. And you know that. And so we just lift them up to you and pray your healing over their lives. And God, for us here today that may need healing touch, just to know that you got us. No matter what we're going through, you are with us. We pray that today as well. We lift up to you the caregivers, those who struggle even to get through the next minute, much less the next day, the next week. They can't even think that far ahead. Oh God, we ask that you give them strength. You anoint them with your holy presence so they know that they are not alone. They are not alone. Just as we celebrate today that we are not alone because we have Jesus Christ in our lives. Oh God, we thank you for just the many blessings you have upon us, the abundance of your love and grace and mercy. And we just come and we say thank you. We ask, oh God, that you just be with us next week. We ask that you guide our steps and guide our mouth, that the words we speak will be edifying, will be building up, will be encouraging, so that it can change the world around us. There's so much negativity. We have the power and the authority to change that with our words, because we are created in your image as your likeness. And God, today we just thank you for this opportunity to worship you and ask these things in the beautiful name of Jesus. And with the confidence of children, we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen. If my ushers will come forward. Thank you.
Please stand.
Celebrating the baptism of the Lord Sunday. We need time to just really engage with the scripture today. It's something we're familiar with. It's something that we speak on in the Methodist Church yearly. I think it's important for us to engage with some of the rhythms of the church to make sure we hit these places. But sometimes hitting them everywhere, people say, well, I've heard it. And they don't listen as intently. So I'm asking you to listen with new ears today. I'm going to start with verse 11 and then go to 13 through 17. It's Matthew chapter 3. This is John the Baptist speaking. Okay. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with Holy Spirit and fire. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. And John tried to prevent him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and are you coming to me? But Jesus answered and said, permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he allowed him. When he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. This is the word of our Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
they're all managing these steps better than me.
They're a little tall for me, so I'm not real steady on them. Are y'all good? Is God good to you? I just need to ask. Is he good? Yes? Do you know that he's good? Know that you know that you know. Yada, yada, yada. Yes, amen. All right. Let's talk about baptism. In the United Methodist Church, we baptize by sprinkling, by pouring, and by immersion. The stories are interesting about doing those things. Most of us remember being sprinkled, or even some adults, and some teenagers prefer it, and that's where we have the baptismal bowl, and we just dip our water and place it on the head and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. Pouring's a little different. This one guy said he had a girl who wanted to be poured, and that's not really familiar to us at United Methodist Church, and he wasn't real sure what it's going to look like. So he put down plastic bags and quilts and towels because he didn't want it going all over the place. And he said she was a little wisp of a teenager. And so, well, I mean, he didn't know any better. So he walks up and takes the pitcher of water, baptizer, and pours the whole full pitcher of water upon her. He said she looked like a drowned rat, but she was bad. He realized he didn't need to use that much water in the future. But the water really didn't go anyplace. It just sort of stayed on her. Isn't that amazing? God does amazing things. And then there's immersion, which we're very familiar with because we have a lot of brothers and sisters in Christ that are Baptist, and that is how they baptized and do some of the other traditions. And so it's a beautiful thing. The symbolism is beautiful in immersion. And it is this dying to self, rising up a new creation. I like the water to be moving because I want all that ick to be washed away. Amen? We don't need it. Let it go on down the river. And it's just this beautiful symbolism about dying to self, being raised up. I think I told you the story of the first time I had confirmation was the first year I was a pastor, and that was 2000. And I had these three young men that wanted to be baptized and they wanted to be immersed. Christy learned a big lesson that day. It was March on the plateau. You do not go in the river in March on the plateau to baptize. I think the first one almost drowned because I didn't in the name of the Father and the Son and the. After that, I was numb and I could do it, right? It was just, so I learned something. And so what I want to invite you into, today we're going to remember our baptism, but I'm going to invite you into another invitation of doing so. Sometime this summer, I haven't decided when, June or July, we're going to go down to a place where the river flows, right? We want moving water, and we're going to have a picnic as a church. And for those who have not been baptized that would like to be baptized by immersion, we can do that. But also, if you would like to remember your baptism by immersion. Because in the United Methodist Church, we believe in one baptism. It took us to 1996 to figure that out. We are slow. But we did finally figure that out because Scripture tells us, right? One Lord, one baptism. And this is what we figured out, and this is what we believe. What do we do when we're baptized? Absolutely nothing, right? What we are on is this receiving end of grace, of Holy Spirit, of God naming and claiming us as his own, becoming part of the family of God. It's all this beautiful stuff that takes place, and we don't do a thing but receive it. And so in the Methodist Church, in our wisdom and in our, you know, we had a committee. We're very Methodist. Anyway, it took us a while, but we came up with this. If we aren't doing anything in baptism but receiving, and God is doing all the work, well, then we don't need another baptism because God does it right the first time. Amen? Now, if man was doing it, we'd probably need to be baptized frequently. But see, God is involved in baptism. And so we figure he does it right the first time. So then the United Methodist Church, in its wisdom, came up with the service of remembering our baptism, because it's important to do that. And so the sign and symbol of baptism is what? Water, right? The sign and symbol, the liturgical words, the outward and visible sign. Water's the outward and visible sign of an inward invisible grace. Okay, so water is our sign and symbol for baptism. And so I just wanted you to know that, so that when we get into the word today, we can look at what's happening here. You see, Jesus goes, and when he, after he's in the wilderness, says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." The Greek word is metanoia, and it means to repent, to change your mind about something. Repenting means that you are choosing to go in a different direction. Usually, instead of a 360, going in a circle, you're doing a 180, turning to go in another direction. But we are baptized. This is something interesting that the church has believed from the beginning. We are baptized into a life of repentance. Now, repentance is not something that church talks about much now. Oh, yes, we go to Jesus Christ, and we should, to be forgiven of our sins, right? That's what he did on the cross for us. And so we can do that. When we make those mistakes, we can go to him and ask for forgiveness. My brothers and sisters, we will be forgiven if we've accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. That's the condition, accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And with that, we are forgiven. We need to receive the forgiveness. So many times we come, I've done it, okay, let's just put it out there. You come forward and you bring in the same thing up every time you come to the altar, every time you pray, "Lord, forgive me for this." You know why? It's because we can't let it go. And you know why we can't let it go? It's because we haven't received the forgiveness. So many times people say, "I haven't forgiven myself." My brothers and sisters, if Jesus Christ has forgiven you, you need to receive that in the fullness of what's being offered to you. And then when we receive it, we claim it. We say, "Yes, I have been forgiven of this. Finally, I receive it, God. Now I don't have to walk in it anymore. I don't have to have it a part of my life." And then we proclaim it. The thing that we do is proclaim it. That's what profession of faith, when our young people come in through confirmation or people come into the church, they come in on profession of faith, professing what God has done for us through this forgiveness that we've claimed and received. But there's another step when we've done that. We're studying Daniel on Wednesday nights, and in the first chapter of Daniel, Daniel says, "I purposed in my heart that I was not going to defy." At that time, it was the eating, okay? Because he was taken into the king's palace, and he was being taught to be a servant to the king. And so the king wanted him fat and healthy. So he gave him his food and his wine to drink. And Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are Jews. They decide not to defile themselves. But they purposed in their hearts. And I love that wording. Because there are times when we purpose in our hearts. We are choosing with everything we've got not to do something again. Right? We just ask forgiveness for it. We've received it. We've claimed it. And we're proclaiming been forgiven. But what about changing our minds and changing our direction and repenting and decide not to do it again? See, that's an additional step that we need to take, is to repent. Now, by golly, when you have repented of it and chosen and purposed in your heart not to do it again, if you do it again, baby, you know you did it again and you hit your knees. But see, we just take this forgiveness and go on. We don't decide to change our hearts, our minds, who we are, the things we do. And that gets us in trouble, which is why we once again come before Jesus with the same thing. Repentance, according to the early church, baptism brought you into the sign of water, brought you into a life of repentance, purposing in our hearts, changing our minds, doing it differently because we choose to do so because of what Jesus Christ has done for us, in us, and through us. Amen? Can't get an amen. All right, just checking. All right. Pretty bad when I amen myself, isn't it? Amen. Okay. So, I'll talk a minute about what happens when we're baptized. It's this overflowing, beautiful thing of love and grace and mercy and Holy Spirit just poured out on us. It's given to us. We are brought into the family of God. And I just think, you know what? It's justifying grace. How many of you know Wesley and Methodist understanding of grace? Yeah, okay. You've heard it, you just don't remember it. But it's gonna sound familiar. There is this grace that goes before we know Jesus Christ, before we know anything about him, is called prevenient grace. And it can be done by people just being in service to us and loving on us. It's just that type. It could happen through music. Sometimes music draws us there. There's just something about a particular artist and what they're singing just speaks to our heart, and it can point us there. It can come through art. It can come through friends. It can come through any way. It's a grace that goes before that points us, always pointing us toward Christ. Amen. Sometimes God puts people in our lives to that. And then with this prevenient grace, at some point, we come to justifying grace. Justifying grace is that moment when we accept Jesus Christ. We realize we aren't worthy, that we are sinners, and we need Jesus Christ for our lives. That acceptance. Wesley believed that we needed grace before. He honestly believed that we could not come to that moment of surrender and submission and acceptance of Jesus Christ without God's grace working in us. And it's called justifying grace. Isn't that beautiful? Part of justifying grace, being reconciled, being forgiven, having Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the sign or the sacrament that goes with that is baptism, water. And then Wesley believed that after that, that we lived in a life of sanctification, sanctifying grace. This grace that works in us, the Holy Spirit working in us to continually help us to grow, moving us from milk to meat, helping us grow from a child in discipleship to a mature disciple, all of those things. And this is where we are in sanctifying grace. If you've been baptized, you're living in sanctifying grace. But this is what he truly believed. I love it. Is that we are going along in sanctifying grace. I don't know about you, but I've had moments where my journey just sort of stopped, and this is a good old-fashioned term. I don't know if you know it, backslide. And how many of you have heard backslide? Have you backslid? All right. No, that's a good old-fashioned backslide. Okay. But in grace, that can happen, can't it? That things happen in our lives, and it just takes us over, and we're no longer focusing on God and no longer just working on our discipleship and that relationship with Jesus Christ. Somehow we've gotten distracted. For me, it's always distractions, and I have dreams with distractions, so obviously I'm distracted. But anyway, it's whatever, and you sort of slide back a little bit, but you never go back. Listen, my brothers and sisters, if you've had that moment of justifying grace, if you've been baptized and you're living in sanctification, even if you backslide, you ain't going back to that moment. Okay? That's what John Wesley believed. He believed that you can be here and you may
back a little bit, but you ain't going all the way back there, my brothers and sisters, because you learned something. You weren't the same person you were then. You weren't the infant in Christ you were then. And so you pick up, and then you move forward again. And so it's this beautiful ebb and flow, depending on how we're going on our journeys, right? Sometimes we're stronger, other times we're weaker, depending on what's going on in life, all right? And so the goal is Christian perfection. Now, in my ordination vows, I had to say that I was going on to perfection, and I believe I would achieve it in my lifetime. But for John Wesley, Christian perfection is Christ-like. Okay? And he honestly believed that while we want to be that, all right, that it's not really a stationary place that once you get there, you stay there, you made it, you're Christ-like, and amen, I'm good, right? Doesn't work that way. He believed that there are moments in our sanctifying grace working in us that we hit that moment of Christian perfection where we are like Jesus in that moment, but we don't stay there and we fall back in, right? Isn't that beautiful? A beautiful flow. Because if you're thinking that, you know, we just move ahead and we keep moving ahead, my brothers and sisters, we know the reality of life isn't that. But John Wesley set it up, his beautiful grace. The sacrament for sanctifying grace is what? We take it once a month. Holy Communion, isn't it? It's an opportunity to engage once again Jesus Christ in a holy way. So I give you that to help you understand that baptism is this justifying grace. It's this beautiful thing that takes place. And why do we want to remember it? Why is it important? Because it becomes a desire to once again have that moment when you encounter that water and you remember that you were named and claimed, and that even though we aren't worthy, he deems us worthy through the blood of Jesus Christ to be reconciled. We remember our baptism and are thankful. Today, my brothers and sisters, we are going to remember our baptism and be thankful. As I said, the sign and symbol of baptism is water. A gentleman in seminary, and he got up and he had his water bottle, and his water bottle dropped and water went all over him and all over everything else, and I didn't laugh. Wasn't that good? Instead, I said, and I don't think he really appreciated, but I was very Methodist at the time. I said, remember your baptism and be thankful. I'm not so sure he truly appreciated the fullness of that statement at the time, but it does remind us of what water is. I love to think of water. I think of the downpour of rain and where you just get drenched and it's all over you, and I think that's how God's grace falls. Amen. Sometimes it's like a mist, and we get a lot of that here where it's just real light. You can barely see it, but after a while you realize you're pretty wet. That's God's grace. I like to think of God's grace as a brook that trickles, and you just hear that beautiful sound. His grace can be like that sometimes, right? Just trickling down. And then sometimes, sometimes His grace is like a thundering waterfall where it just brings you to your knees and is held. It's God's grace. Maybe God's grace is like the great ocean or the sea that sometimes is perfect like glass, and other times stormy and roaring with big waves and violence. But see, God's grace can hit us that way sometimes, just knock us out. Amen? Okay. And Scripture tells us, water. Jesus is living water. My brothers and sisters, all life needs water. We need water. We need baptism, right? We need to be reminded continually when we drink water, living water, because we need it. Water is the sign and symbol, speaks to us in many ways and reveals to us in many ways our God and what Jesus did for us. So today, my brothers and sisters, you're invited to come forward. You can put your fingers lightly in it. You can touch your forehead. You can baptize, remember your baptism by putting it on your head. You can do what you want. But remember your baptism and be thankful, because it's an amazing thing we have received. Come and remember your baptism as you feel led. We'll start with the choir so we have some order. And we'll move this way for those who wish to partake.
Remember your baptism. everyone come forward.
Who would like to take this holy moment to engage with water, to remember your baptism and be thankful? Let us pray. Almighty God, we just thank you for another encounter. They are so special in this time. It happens to be through life-giving water. We remember our baptisms today, remembering what took place, that holy and sacred moment that has forever changed our lives. And God, we thank you that it's your grace that works in and through us. Oh God, send us forth as your people to continue to carry the light into the world. We ask these things in the beautiful name of Jesus. Amen. Before our closing hymn today, if Miss Karen Hutton will come up. Miss Karen is joining the church today by profession of faith, and so I have some questions to ask her, and then there will be a response that you'll give. Questions. Here they are. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Will you support the United Methodist Church? Okay. And will you, as a member of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? Members of the household of God, I commend this person to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love. And the congregational response is, ready? God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ. And in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant and participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Welcome. You are one of us. Woohoo! Amen. Amen. So, Ms. Karen, if you'll go to the back, and so people can greet you as they leave after we finish the closing hymn. Thank you. Welcome. Please stand for our closing hymn. Lift every voice and sing.
Thank you.
my brothers and sisters, go forth in the name of